beautiful night out on the Atlantic Ocean. The seas are calm, there are a million stars in the sky. Captain's gone to bed for the night. Second officer is on the bridge. Up on sun deck, the third officer is trying to charm a young lady from Miami into his bed. She knows what he wants, but she hasn't decided, so she's stalling. What's that star up there? Ah, that is the North Star. And that is how you say the Big Dipper. What's that line of ships on? What's that line of lights on the horizon? That is a ship. Bella, have I told you your eyes are like stars? The young woman points to a small flickering light in the water, much closer than the lights on the horizon. What's that down there? Third officer is getting pretty fed up at this point. He hasn't a clue. That is a buoy. Let's go to my cabin for a drink. The buoy is crying for help. Soggy and exhausted drug smuggler has been rescued by the crew and is on deck. His small plane rests on the bottom of the ocean. The little flickering light that the woman had seen was his big lighter, which he was flicking frantically as he sat atop floating wreckage, trying to get the attention of the ship going by. I didn't see that particular rescue. I was on the other side of the ship serving cocktails at the time. That's what I did for 8 months in the early 80s. I started law school. I got mono, or discovered I had mono on the second day. I dropped out, and I deferred admission till the following September. After 2 months, when I finally recovered, I found myself flat broke, bored to tears with living in my parents' guest room, and longing for adventure. It came to me one morning as I was watching reruns of Love Boat. I would work on a cruise ship. A few phone calls later, I had a huge stroke of luck. A Costa Cruise Lines cocktail waitress had gotten appendicitis that week and had been taken off the ship. They put me through the hiring manager. Have you ever waitressed before? Sure! I lied through my teeth. I was hired. I was so excited. I envisioned a life of adventure, excitement, and glamour. 2 days later, I was in Miami, climbing up the crude gangplank into the bowels of the Flavia Sea. Now, the SS Flavia Sea was not like cruise ships today. Cruise ships today are these 20-story massive floating resort hotels with zip lines and ski runs and rock climbing walls and thousands of passengers and thousands of crew. Not the Flavia. The Flavia had 850 passengers at full occupancy and about 230 crew members. She was an old ocean liner which Costa had renovated and was using on short cruises between Miami and the Bahamas. The old girl was held together with spit and duct tape, and sometimes the tape didn't hold. So I climbed up the crew gangplank. About 20 minutes later, I was working my first shift in the lounge of the Flavia Sea. I spent the next 6 hours stumbling around the lounge, trying to figure out the fine art of carrying 15 drinks on the tray, remembering who they go to, making change with the other hand. The heels were a lot higher than they'd been the day before. The ship was moving under me. The bartenders were yelling at me. I was screwing up drink orders. The bar manager was giving me stink eye. When I finally looked up from my drink tray, I realized that there was a group of officers at the bar. They were taking bets, I found out later, on whether my breasts were going to make an appearance before the end of the night. I'd been given this uniform, this hideous polyester double knit thing that made me look like a cross between a serving wench and a cheap German beer hall. And a little Bo Peep on acid. Small, it was too tight and too low cut, and every time I bent over to take a drink order, I was sure I was going to drop a boob in someone's heart. At the end of my shift, I went to the bar and started tallying up my orders. I had made all of $7 in tips. It's got to get better tomorrow, I thought. At least now I get to go to sleep. Tomorrow's going to be better. That's when I discovered that they posted the schedule. During my shift, they posted a schedule behind the bar. I had worked from 1 p.m. to 7 p.m. and I was going to have a break till 9 p.m., 2 hours. Then work from 9 to 1 a.m. in the lounge, at which point I was to switch to the disco and work from 1 a.m. to 3 a.m. in the disco for a total of 12 hours. I started feeling really sorry for myself. Little did I know that for 12 hours, cocktail waitresses had it better than the waiters did. They worked 15 hours a day. For the next 8 months, I worked 7 days a week, 12 hours a day, in 2 or 3 shifts a day. For this work, I made $180 a month, and about the same amount in tips. Of course, I didn't spend much of it. I didn't have much opportunity to do so. I saved most of my money. I lived in a small windowless cabin with 3 other cocktail waitresses and 2 sets of bunk beds. That was the official occupancy. Unofficially, we shared our cabin with our 4 boyfriends. My boyfriend was Pasquale the pastry chef. I just gotta say, there's nothing like being wooed by a pastry chef. I can still feel the butter coursing through my veins. Now, the ships today, there are usually about equal numbers of male and female crew members, not in my day. On the Flavia, we had 300 men, 300 male crew members, and 20 women. That's 300 predominantly Italian crew members. Most of them from small towns south of Naples. Most of them not really familiar with concepts like equality of women or feminism. All of them on 8-month contracts far from home and family. Every man on Flavia wanted a shipboard girlfriend. I soon realized that until and unless I had a boyfriend, I was not going to make friends on the ship. Male friends, at least. This issue of sex was always front and center present. Once I had a boyfriend, once they knew that Pasquale was my boyfriend, the guys treated me mostly like a sister. Now, it's not to say that the guys who didn't have shipboard girlfriends went lonely for 8 months at a time. Officially, there was absolutely no fraternization between passengers and crew. Unofficially, that just made the game more interesting. Flavia was truly the love boat. She was the only ship in the fleet that had a crew pool on a deck just below the passenger pool. And notwithstanding 15 hours of work, after the lunch shift, the waiters would come up to the crew pool and they'd pose in the little, tiny little Speedos, lots of suntan oil, muscles rippling as they flirted with the passengers on the deck above. And they scored. Oh, literally, quite literally. At one point, they had a fishing tournament. They had the chart behind the bar to keep score. A one-night stand with a passenger was worth 5 points. If you got with a passenger for an entire cruise, that was worth 20. And there were ratings for individual acts as well. I don't remember them all. I remember that a blowjob was worth more than a kiss. The winner of the fishing tournament got bragging rights only. Well, he also only almost got himself castrated when 5 of his conquests came on a short cruise a few weeks later at the same time. Below decks, the official, not the official language, the language of choice was Italian. I learned to speak Italian quickly, fluently, ungrammatically, with a lot of Neapolitan slang and dialect mixed in. For instance, one time, well, I kept hearing the guys repeating the phrase, "Me ne frega," and I thought, what does that mean? I hear, oh, we could go here, we could go there, "Me ne frega." I asked a friend on the ship what it meant. He said, well, it means it doesn't matter to me. A few nights later, I was serving an Italian passenger, a friend of one or a relative of one of the officers, and she handed me a large bill, and she said, "I'm sorry, I don't have change." And I said, "Oh, it's all right, signora." And then I wanted to show off my Italian. Men of fragrant cuts. Her mouth literally dropped open. And I could hear glassware crashing right behind me. It turns out that men of fragrant cuts means, literally, I wouldn't jerk off over it. As a passenger, and as I walked into the main lounge, not my ship, but another one, as I walked into the main lounge, from behind the bar I hear, "Susanna, men of fragrant cuts." My reputation lasted much longer than my job. I was actually only on Flavia for 3 months. Costa at some point decided that she'd become too expensive to repair, and they sold Flavia to the Chinese. As we sailed into Miami one day, I was informed that I was being transferred to the Carlos Sea, the SS Carlos Sea. By 5 o'clock that evening, I was serving cocktails in the lounge of the Carlos Sea as she sailed from San Juan, Puerto Rico on her weekly cruise through the Caribbean. As for Flavia, she caught fire and sank shortly after the sail. Wow. Come to think of it, all of the ships I worked on eventually caught fire and sank somewhere. My 8 months on ships were not nearly as glamorous as I expected, but they were educational, exotic, exhausting and educational. I learned rudimentary self-defense. I learned the importance of U.S. labor and employment laws. I learned a great deal about human behavior and about the limits of my own endurance. I learned to be careful when I used Italian that I learned from sailors. And I learned whenever I see a flickering light out on the water, I should listen very carefully because you never know when you're going to meet a buoy in distress. Thank you.